Right. So I have discussed few questions in my earlier video, right? And these are the four questions that I had discussed in my earlier video, which are question number one. These questions are from set X. And question number one, the answer is option number two. This was a question on XRD, okay? And the answer was option number two. Then we have question number three. This was based on point groups, that which of the following has same symmetry group as NH3. Now NH3 has C3V point group. And so the correct answer was chloroform. CHCl3 also has C3V point group. So question number three, option number four. Question number six, the option number three is the correct one. And the question number six was pertaining to UV spectroscopy, where which of the following transitions require the least amount of energy. So the answer was the least amount of energy is required by N2 pi star followed by pi 2 pi star, then N2 sigma star, and the highest energy required is from sigma to sigma star, right? Then question number 36, this was based on the cobalt complexes. Which of the following cobalt complexes has a high spin complex, forms a high spin complex? So the answer was COF6 3-. So these are the four questions that I have discussed in my previous video, and this is a question based on spectroscopy, NMR and IR, organic spectroscopy. So we look into this question, how to solve it. Now all the questions were pretty simple. Like I told you in my previous videos that the questions are going to be very simple, but they are going to be a little conceptual. So if you have seen my videos on carbonyl compounds, which I had uploaded about 10 to 15 days back, the stretching frequencies for carbonyl compounds, it would have been easier for you to solve, right? So we have been given IR. The IR values were given as 3400 and 1680. Now 3400 and 1680, and if you see over here, first you see the most unique thing in the NMR. If you see the unique thing in the NMR is that at 5.8, we are getting a 1H NMR, which is D2O exchangeable. That is, it is a very polar proton. I mean, it is an acidic proton, right? So definitely it corresponds to OH, because the IR is shown to be 3400, and the OH stretching is at 3400 centimeter inverse. So definitely there is a OH group present. So only on that basis you can cancel out one option, which is option number C, because option number C does not have a OH group. So it does not correspond to this NMR value 5.8 or the IR value 3400. This compound cannot show that IR value. So this is cancelled out. Now if you have seen my carbonyl compounds video, you would know that 1680, okay, 1680 is very less for esters. So if you see there are two esters present, and esters, I told you, show IR stretching frequency around 1750, whereas ketones show around 1725. Plus this ketone, which is in option number D, there's only one ketone and we have two ester groups. This ketone also is in conjugation. So if the ketones or the esters are in conjugation, their IR frequency is reduced. Why? Because the CO bond obtains a partial double bond character due to the resonance with the phenyl ring. So because of that partial double bond character, the frequency reduces, right? So, but I mean, the frequency reduction cannot be that drastic for a ester that from 1750, because of the conjugation with the phenyl ring, it should go up to 1680. I mean, it does not sound plausible, okay? So, but you still have to confirm. You cannot be 100% sure, so you need to confirm. Now, what is the one different thing you can see over here? You can see that we have 2.3 for methyl groups and 3.9 for methyl groups. So, 3.9 for methyl group means this methyl group is highly T-shielded. That is, it is attached to an oxygen, I mean, an electronegative atom, could be oxygen. So, in this case, if you see all the ME groups, all the methyl groups, 1, 2 and 3, all the methyl groups are attached to electron withdrawing oxygen atom or hetero atom, right? So this will also not give you any answer. But what if you have seen my NMR spectroscopy videos and tricks on NMR spectroscopy, you would know that when you get substitutions on the phenyl ring, what gives you the answer? The answer is given by the coupling constants, whether it is a doublet or a singlet. So whenever you have phenyl groups with substituents attached to the phenyl groups, or the phenyl groups, whatever you like to call it, you need to consider the coupling constants. I mean, what is the splitting pattern, right? So if you see 7.8, this is means, now generally phenyl protons show a value of 7 to 7.5, okay? But over here you see 7.8, that means highly deshielded, 7.8. This one is highly deshielded, 7.8 means electron withdrawing group, strong electron withdrawing group is attached nearby. Then we have at 7, which is again a doublet. So these both are doublets, okay? And then we have one singlet at 6.5. That means at 6.5 means it is very, very shielded. At 6.5, if a phenyl proton shows a value of 6.5, that means it's very, very shielded. So if you see in the options, which ones are the singlet? First of all, identify the hydrogens which will give a singlet. This hydrogen phenyl proton will give a singlet, okay? Then this hydrogen will give a singlet. And over here, this hydrogen will give a singlet. And now the singlet is at 6.5. That means very shielded. If you see over here, we have an electron withdrawing group attached and an electron donating group, OH group. But then we have an electron withdrawing group also attached. If you see over here, we have methyl group, which is an electron donating group, and we have an OH group, which is electron donating. So this could show a value of 6.5. And over here, this also has a good chance of showing at 6.5 because we have a hydroxy group, that is OH group, and we have a ONA group, methoxy group. So this methoxy group and OH group both are good electron donors. So they will also shield this proton because they are ortho-paradirecting. Similarly, over here, these are also, this shows plus I effect ortho, and OH also is ortho-paradirecting. So these protons will be very shielded. But this proton, there is an electron withdrawing group attached, and there is an electron donating group also attached. So the effect will be neutralized and you would not obtain a value of around 6.5. So this is not the correct answer, option number A. Now the only two options you are left with is B and D, and nothing will give you away, because if you see, there is a value at 7.8, okay. Now if you see this, now it is very difficult to identify which is the correct answer, because over here also, this methyl can show a value around 2.3 to 2.5, this methyl group can also show a value of around 2.3 to 2.5. Like in toluene, if you take the example of toluene, in toluene the methyl group shows a value of 2.3. This methyl, this proton shows a value of 2.3, right? And we have a methyl group over here, so it can show a value of 2.3. This methyl group also over here, which is attached to the ketone, can also show you a value of 2.3. Like in acetone, you get a value of 2.05, right? But generally, this methyl group, the protons attached to this methyl group, when it is attached to a ketone, it can give you around 2.3. So it becomes very difficult for you to understand, right? Until and unless you practice a lot, maybe then you can differentiate between that. That is why we have been given the IR. From the IR, you can directly know that 1680 it can only be shown by a ketone and not by a ester, right? So the correct answer is option number D, according to me. And let's see what the answer key says, but I am quite sure that this is the correct answer because this is the only plausible explanation for the NMR and the IR values that are given. 1680 for an ester, I have read a lot of books, but I have never seen 1680 for an ester unless and until, you know, there is a highly conjugated ester present or some kind of anomaly is taking place. Conjugation with ketones are more likely to show a value of 1680, and I think this is the reason why IR was given. If the IR was not given, then also we could have found out the answer. Then it would have been very difficult to find out the answer. So the only reason the IR was given, I think, was because to differentiate between the ester and the ketone. Otherwise, there was no role of the IR. So I think the correct answer is option number D. If you think there's some different plausible explanation of why there could be some other correct answer, please feel free to comment down below, and I'll look into it if your explanation is quite valid. But according to me, it is option number D. I'm 95% sure, and we'll wait for the answer key, right? So I hope the explanation was satisfactory to you, and stay tuned for more questions and answers from TIFR 2018. Thank you.